Stand by while NCLA cuts through the noise to signal abuse of administrative power. This is Administrative Static with Mark Chenoweth and John Vecchione.
Welcome back to Administrative Static. Lovely to have you with us today. I wanted in this segment to get into a kind of judicial deference that the New Civil Liberties Alliance has been working to oppose. Explain a little bit about judicial deference. Explain this particular kind of judicial deference and what's going on with it, and then some recent developments that that might be of interest to our listeners. So when I say judicial deference, what I mean is there is a doctrine that the federal courts have created, actually several related doctrines the federal courts have created, that allow a judge to defer to the legal interpretation of the federal government, of the administrative agency that is before the court. And the logic here is that a federal agency has expertise in a particular area. And so whether it's a federal statute that applies to that agency, so imagine the Environmental Protection Agency interpreting an environmental statute, or whether it's interpreting its own regulation, the EPA is interpreting some regulation the EPA itself put out, that the agency is in a better position to interpret that law or that regulation than the judge because of their expertise and their proximity to the situation. That's the logic. The problem with that, as you may be able to discern, is that if the judge is deferring to one of the two parties in front of that judge, what does that mean has happened to the other party in front of the court? Well, obviously, they're not getting a fair trial. The reason that you go to court is to have an independent judge. And the Constitution goes through a lot of effort to create an independent judiciary. And yet, if the judge gives up that judicial independence and instead defers to the judgment of the executive branch, then you don't have that independence, and the due process of that person has been violated. So one of the particular forms of judicial deference that exists out there, and there are a dozen or more kinds of deference, is called Stinson deference, S-T-I-N-S-O-N, Stinson deference. And this kind of deference comes from an early 1990s Supreme Court case, and it involves deferring to the commentary to the U.S. sentencing guidelines. So you may or may not know that there are U.S. federal sentencing guidelines for all criminal cases, and they used to be mandatory. The Supreme Court has now decided that they're not mandatory, but judges still rely on these federal sentencing guidelines to help guide the length of sentences that they hand out to criminal defendants who have been found guilty. The guidelines really only come into effect after a guilty a decision has been rendered by the judge or the jury.
And Mark, it should be noted that the reason they're not mandatory anymore is partly a separation of powers issue, that the judges are allowed to judge. And the sentencing guidelines were trying to make sentences more uniform across the country. They didn't want you to be in front of a lenient judge or a harsh judge, and people have large differences. But the Supreme Court, partially for these reasons you're talking about, said, no, they can't be mandatory because we have a duty to judge.
That's right. That's a good point. And so here again, the independence of the judiciary was at issue. But with the sentencing guidelines, there's also something called the commentary to the sentencing guidelines. And that's where the way that the guidelines typically get created and amended is that there's a U.S. Sentencing Commission that looks at the guidelines. They'll propose changes. Those changes will go in front of Congress. Congress has a chance to vote those down, and then they become officially a part of the amended guidelines. But there's also commentary that does not go before Congress. This commentary is things that the commissioners themselves put out, sort of interpreting what they think the guidelines mean in a particular place. But that commentary, as again, does not go before Congress, and therefore does not have the imprimatur or the legitimacy of the democratic branch of government approving that. And that's really important when you're talking about criminal penalties, to have a sign-off from Congress on that. And so as a result, the New Civil Liberties Alliance has been pushing back against a deference to the commentary, to the guidelines, because, again, there's no reason why the independent judges should be giving up their view of the guidelines in favor of this commentary that didn't go before Congress, is not officially part of the guidelines, and can make a huge difference in the length of sentence that someone gets, particularly if it's their third offense, or there's a question about whether a particular offense is their third offense, or are they going to be sentenced as a career criminal or not. That can make a huge difference in the length of someone's sentence. So I wanted to let folks know that there was an important victory in the Third Circuit, a court of appeals, on December 1st in a case called U.S. v. Malik Nasir. And the Third Circuit, sitting en banc, again, that's all the judges at the Third Circuit, sat together and decided that in the Third Circuit, they were no longer going to defer to the commentary in the sentencing guidelines. And that was good news for Mr. Nasir, but it's better news for judicial independence and for due process of all defendants going forward. And this issue exists in the Tenth Circuit as well. There's a case and I don't remember if this one comes out of Colorado or one of the other states in the Tenth Circuit, but there's a case called U.S. v. Lovato where the Tenth Circuit reached the opposite decision of the Third Circuit. They decided to continue to allow judges to defer to the commentary of the guidelines. And it looks like that case might be appealed up to the U.S. Supreme Court within the next short time. There's another case currently pending at the U.S. Supreme Court out of the Second Circuit, a court of appeals. And perhaps I should have mentioned that the Third Circuit, where the Nasir case was, the Third Circuit oversees the states of Pennsylvania, New Jersey, and Delaware. The Second Circuit oversees the states of New York, Connecticut, and Vermont. And a case out of the Second Circuit called U.S. v. Zimian Tab currently is sitting at the United States Supreme Court. A cert petition has been filed. The court has not yet decided whether to grant that cert petition, but the issue is before the U.S. Supreme Court right now. And I wanted to mention two other cases in this regard. The first is a case called U.S. v. Havis out of the Sixth Circuit. And this was the first one that NCLA got involved in a couple of years ago, where we had jumped in and encouraged the Sixth Circuit to not recognize deference to commentary to the sentencing guidelines. The Sixth Circuit agreed with us in that case. And so you have the Sixth Circuit and now the Third Circuit on one side of the issue. You have the Tenth Circuit and the Second Circuit on the other side of the issue. So that creates what we call a circuit split, where you have a number of federal circuit courts on either side of an important issue that has a big impact on criminal defendants. And this one, I think the other thing maybe I should mention about this is there's usually a principle called the rule of lenity. And what it means is if there's an ambiguity in a criminal statute, typically we want that ambiguity to be resolved in favor of the criminal defendant. And you might think, well, I'm a law and order guy. I don't believe in that. Well, I'm a law and order guy too, but the reason that the rule of lenity is important is because you don't want people to be imprisoned or to have their sentences lengthened based on something that isn't a clear violation of the law. That puts too much power in the hands of the prosecutor. It puts too little ability for someone to avoid the cut of the law in advance. And if you're talking about depriving someone of their actual liberty, of throwing someone in prison, you really want to make sure they violated the law and that there wasn't some unclear thing that someone wouldn't have necessarily known was a criminal penalty before you put them away. So that's part of what is at issue here. And with, as I say, with this split on the two sides of the court, I think with two circuit courts on either side of this split, John, it's something that the Supreme Court is likely to take up.
That's it. They usually reject. If the circuit courts all agree, the Supreme Court usually doesn't take it. If there's a circuit split, it's more likely. And having served in the Third Circuit, I would just add they also, New Jersey, Delaware, and Pennsylvania, and of course, the Virgin Islands, for some reason, unknown.
I have noticed that the warmer island climates seem to get divided across the circuit. So I think the First Circuit gets Puerto Rico and then the Virgin Islands, and then Hawaii's out there with the Ninth Circuit and Guam and so forth. So
they all got a place for judicial conferences, I guess.
Is that what it is? Okay. But I also wanted to call attention to a concurrence by Judge Stefanos Bibas in the Third Circuit in the U.S. v. Nasir case, because and we'll have this up on NCLA's website at some point in the next week or so. But this concurrence from Judge Bibas is just fantastic and really goes into a great amount of detail as to why we have to be concerned about judicial deference, particularly in this context of criminal sentencing. And it just does a wonderful job of talking about the liberty interests at stake here and why folks should be concerned about this. I should mention that the New Civil Liberties Alliance is also representing a gentleman in the Eighth Circuit. This is a case out of Arkansas, a gentleman named Marcus Broadway, who has similarly been deprived of his due process because of a judge deferring to the sentencing guidelines commentary in the Eighth Circuit. And the Eighth Circuit, it's not just, it's Arkansas and Missouri and Iowa and Minnesota and North and South Dakota and Nebraska. I think that's all of them. And so we're going to be representing him. We're going to file a cert petition in the United States Supreme Court. And so along with the cert petition in TAB and potentially one from the Tenth Circuit in the Lovato case, the Supreme Court will also be getting a cert petition from NCLA, from the Eighth Circuit in U.S. v. Broadway. And we may be able to delve into that case in a little more detail at some time down the road. But I just wanted our listeners, Vec, to know about this judicial deference issue and the importance of judges maintaining their independence, of judges according due process, even to criminal defendants, especially to criminal defendants, and the way that this Stinson deference issue prevents that from happening.
Well, especially deferring to the government when it's prosecuting someone is probably the worst time to defer.
Absolutely. Well said, and really appreciate everyone being with us today. And look for that UFB here decision and concurrence from Judge Bibas on NCLA.legal website.
Welcome back, everyone. It's John Vecchione of Administrative Static. And for our final segment today, I've discussed this case before, but I think it's going to be a pretty big one out of the Supreme Court this term. And it's changed its name. It's AMG Capital Management LLC versus the FTC. There were two cases. One was out of the Seventh Circuit. For some reason, the Supreme Court took them both, consolidated them. And the credit bureau case was on the top of the caption. And they dropped it, and now it's just AMG, which is out of the Ninth, which is California and Oregon and Washington, Hawaii, and Arizona. But in any event, it's a very interesting case about government power and whether words matter or not. Because, as I've discussed before, Section 13B of the Federal Trade Commission Act allows the Federal Trade Commission, which has enormous jurisdiction, basically every commercial activity in the country, they get to prosecute you or bring a case against you. It's not a criminal case, a civil case, on that you've had a deceptive or unfair trade practice. And what that is usually known only to them, but not in this case, because it's got to be set up front. In AMG Capital Management, the AMG and its owner appear from all of the pleadings to be pretty guilty of doing payday loans where the terms were kind of hidden in all the legal gobbledygook. And they supposedly took people for over $1 billion. So as often happens in Supreme Court cases, to vindicate rights, you often have bad actors vindicating those rights just so they can get away with something. So the reason I bring it up now is because the FTC, the lead plaintiff on lead lawyer on this is Alden F. Abbott, who's a very smart guy, good guy. And he has put in a brief telling the Supreme Court that they have to keep this 13B power. And what's that? Well, 13B of the Federal Trade Commission Act says that if they decide a business has been deceptive or unfair, they can go to federal court and get an injunction. Now, that's what the law says. They can get an injunction. There's no question. They can get an injunction saying, stop doing this, do that, do the other thing. That's what an injunction is. The court tells you to do something or not to do something. And the reason, but they don't just want that because they use it for another purpose. They go into court with an affidavit saying, oh, these guys are going to abscond with all this money. We need to seize it because we're going to disgorge this money at the end. Disgorgement mean is they're going to take all the money back. And we're either going to give it to consumers who were injured, or we're going to put it in the treasury. So they've been doing this for years. And NCLA put in a brief, as I told you in an earlier episode. And the real thing here is it's a creep of administrative power. Because these folks came up with a plan to get the injunction power expanded so they could get money damages. Now, they don't call it money damages because that would be a no-no. That would mean that it was an action at law. And as I've said before, the Constitution requires a jury for any amount of legal damages over $20, which I always look at that clause in the Constitution and I think of Austin Powers, where Dr. Evil says $1 million. But anyway, the number is $20. You get a jury if you have a beef about somebody owes you $21. 19 won't do it. 21 will do it. In any event, so they don't want to have to go before a jury. So they have expanded equitable powers. And they've put in briefs, the government's put in briefs, and a bunch of amicus curiae, which are friends of the court, have put in saying, we got to keep this power, we got to keep this power, because, well, it's kind of a little bit like the Animal House defense. If you saw Animal House, the, not Otter, the other guy stands up and he says, well, we have a long history of existence. Primarily what this brief says is we at the FTC have a long history of doing this thing that the statute doesn't give us the power to do. And so we want to keep doing it. I think that when you have an argument at law, you have to say, well, let's meet the other side's argument. And the big argument here is, what does injunction mean? And what the government says is, well, injunction means everything. Whenever Congress uses the word injunction, it means everything that was in the courts of equity. And historically, there's a very long, this is a long historical document that they filed. They say what the courts of equity could do. And before we had the courts we have today, there were law courts where you took your law actions, where you could get money. And then there were equity courts where you could get your equitable rights taken care of, which are somebody has seized your property and you want it back. They will order you to give it back. So, but what the government does, I think in footnote 12 of this brief, I found it, I was looking, well, what's this footnote about? Well, what they say is that the words don't matter. And this is a very dangerous thing for an agency to say. They say, well, yes, we know that Congress says when they want to give all equitable powers, they say all equitable powers. And all equitable powers means that the statute gives the agency everything, including this disgorgement, all these other things they want. As long as it's a traditional remedy in equity. But here, what's the government doing? The government's saying they said injunction, but we want more than that. Well, how does our system work? Again, separation of powers. When Congress gives you some powers and uses a word that means something, like injunction does, then that's what you get. What the government tries to do here, and many of the amicus say, well, wait a minute, federal courts have full equitable powers. Yes, federal courts do. But the statute gives you your remedies and the words mean something. You can't have, and we can't have in any system of law, have words mean nothing. Or like, I think it's the Red Queen in Alice in Wonderland, mean anything I want them to say today and a different thing tomorrow. So what the FTC is trying to do here is to say, well, whatever word is used by Congress, we will then transmogrify it into what we need and what we want for our administrative purposes. And that's not how it goes. Now, the other thing they say is that AMG Capital and the guy who's frauded people out of $1 billion is a bad guy. You can't let him keep the money because no one should benefit from their own wrongdoing. Well, the answer to that is you're right. And that's why there's lots of way to get the money back. The people themselves can sue for it. The government can do an administrative procedure. Under the FTC's own procedure, they can choose to go and they can get all equitable remedies. They can get damages. They can get penalties. They can get all that stuff, back. It's not like Congress left them powerless. In fact, they can do that before their own ALJs who, as Peggy Little said earlier in this episode for the SEC, are usually very, very pro-agency. So I think that this case is moving forward. It's going to be argued in early January. It's going to be very interesting because the FTC is basically saying that the word injunction means all equitable power. And they have some precedent for that. But as our brief notes and as other people have noted, yes, they do have old precedent to rely on, but that precedent has been misused and has been misused by a whole plan by the FTC to aggrandize power to itself. And they don't respond to that. They don't respond that this power was gotten through a litigation strategy that they've admitted to, that a former FTC official has actually said, yeah, I did it. I'm glad I did it and I'll do it again. So I think that, these briefs are coming in, and what they are is they're very perturbed that the FTC won't be able to go into court and freeze all your assets. Then you can't get a lawyer, and then, of course, they get all the money, because if you don't have a lawyer, it's very, very difficult to fight any of this stuff, because all the agencies do is make an accusation, and then they've got to prove it. But this 13B, the way they've interpreted it, they get to prove it when you don't have a lawyer, and that is very dangerous because lawyers are like everybody else. They like to get paid for their work. And if they're not going to get paid because the government seized all the money and you can't pay them, they can't put in a defense that this wasn't unfair or this wasn't deceptive or the amount of money the government's asking for is way off base. And because of SEC v. Liu that we talked about earlier, which was said here, SEC has disgorgement power, but here's what disgorgement is. It's not everything. It's not everything you own. It means things that you got wrongfully under that statute. So I think that what we have here is a situation where the FTC has tried to expand its power, and now it's put in its argument before the Supreme Court, and its argument is really two, maybe threefold, but its argument is he's a bad guy. You know what I mean? He's a bad guy. We got to go after bad guys. You know, pay no attention to that word over there. We got a bad guy right here, so go get the bad guy. Those type of arguments don't really work too much. Maybe a little bit with Sam Alito on occasion, but they don't work in the Supreme Court that much because the Supreme Court knows that it's making rules for everybody. Bad guys, good guys, neutral guys, people we don't know whether they're good guys or bad guys. That's the whole point of due process, to find out. So those arguments, when they're being made, I think weaken a brief that you've got to, of course, put in what they really did. That always what's at stake should be known. But if you're really pounding on these, this is a bad guy, so you've got to let us do unconstitutional things to him. The Supreme Court's not a great fan of that particular argument. And I think there's a lot of that in these briefs. The second thing is we've done this for a long time, but what they don't grapple with, and I think that you should always hang a light on your weakest point. If you're going to go in there and ask for something big, you should hang a light on your weakest point. And one of the weakest points here is that the Seventh Circuit, which is out in Illinois and Indiana and some Midwestern states there, they said, we started all this with a case called Amy Travel, and we were wrong. And they never say, well, no, you weren't wrong. Don't listen to the Seventh. They just say, don't listen to the Seventh Circuit. You got to grapple with the argument that they found their error. So we will see you all next time. Thank you for being with us. And hopefully the oral argument will go well for the forces of freedom.